Stereo sound is a left and a right channel, right? Well, it can be, but that's boring. So like I said in the intro, this video is all about a different way of thinking about stereo sound. In our stereo recording and mixing videos, we thought of stereo sound as two channels, a left and a right. By the way, I recommend watching those videos if you haven't already, but anyway, with mid-side, as the name suggests, you think of stereo as a middle and a side channel. So how does that work? Well, to explain, I have a mid-side recording setup right here. Again, like a stereo setup, we have two different microphones, but rather than a left and a right microphone, it's a middle and a side microphone. The middle microphone in this setup is a cardioid small diaphragm condenser microphone, a Rode M5 to be precise. You can use just about any microphone you want for the middle microphone, an Omni microphone, supercardioid shotgun mic, or even a bidirectional microphone. It all depends on what you're recording and the result that you want. For the side microphone, however, you always want a microphone with a bidirectional pattern, also known as a figure eight. In this case, we have an AKG P420, which is a multi-pattern large diaphragm condenser. Of course, right now it's set to figure eight. We only want this microphone picking up from the sides, so it's 90 degrees off axis from the middle microphone. The two microphones are right next to each other, so we would say that they're a coincident pair. All right, so now you're probably asking a valid question, which is, how is this a stereo miking technique? I'll explain that in a second, but first, let's quickly record some outdoor ambience with the microphone, like in our stereo recording video. Okay, maybe not. How about some nice amateur piano instead? Okay, so stereo means having a left and a right speaker, not a middle and a side speaker. If we just combine these microphone sources on a stereo output, it'll just be in mono. Well, this is where we get into the idea of matrixing, which is a concept we'll explore more in future videos. Basically, the idea is we're taking a certain number of microphone inputs, processing them, and remapping them to a certain number of speaker outputs. We can represent the matrixing algebraically. Our left speaker channel is equal to our mid channel plus our side channel. Our right speaker channel is equal to our mid channel minus our side channel, or our mid-channel plus a negative side channel. Now you might be wondering, how do we get a negative speaker signal? Well, it's pretty easy, just invert the polarity of the signal. If you're not sure exactly what that means, I have a whole video on phase and polarity. Let's set this up in the box and I can explain it in more detail. In this case, I'm using Reaper, but of course this will work in any DAW or editing program. So I've got my mid channel on one track, I've got my side channel on another track, and I'm going to send my side channel to a third track, then pan the two side tracks hard left and right. I can then invert the polarity of the left track and put the two side tracks together in a group so I can control their volume together. In DAWs that don't have groups, you could use something like a VCA or a stereo aux channel. This is a great time to demonstrate some of the unique qualities of mid-side recording. The first is pretty obvious. You can change the relative volume of the microphones when mixing, which means you can change the stereo width after recording. You can only get so wide before the effect falls apart, but you can get some really wide stereo recordings using mid-side. I'll demonstrate that in a second. The other advantage is that mid-side recordings are completely mono compatible. Because the side channels are perfect opposites of each other, when you combine them, they will completely cancel each other out. That means the center signal will be completely untouched and you won't hear any weird phasing effects. The one downside of mid-side recording is that, because it's a coincident technique, there won't be any time delay between the two channels. That means the technique isn't quite as wide as something like an ortive or spaced pair, but it still gets fairly wide. Okay, with that covered, let's go back and listen to that piano recording I did. I'm going to slowly bring up the volume of the side channel so you can hear how the stereo image widens as I do. You'll notice that as the side channel reaches the same volume as the mid channel, the stereo image falls apart. So another downside for mid-side recording is that for budget sound design productions, the technique isn't super practical. Ideally, you would have a matched pair of small diaphragm condensers for the mid and side microphones, but the only companies that make bidirectional SDCs are very high-end manufacturers like Sennheiser and Shope's, where you'd be spending over $1,000 per microphone. The cheapest option is a Shure Beta 181, which is $500 per mic. If any budget mic manufacturers happen to be watching, if you release a bidirectional SDC, I'd buy it in a heartbeat. That brings us to the question, so why am I talking about mid-side technique if you'll probably never be able to use it in a production? Well, because as it turns out, you can use the idea of mid-side processing when mixing audio that was recorded or mixed with traditional stereo techniques. I briefly mentioned this in my mixing stereo sound video, but you can use mid-side processing to control the width of a normal stereo track. You can also use it to perform different processing on the center and side elements in a mix. To do this, we'll utilize a mid-side encoder. In this case, I'm using Mid-Side Matrix by Goodhertz, which is a free plugin. Let's quickly listen to the scene that I'll use to demonstrate what I'm talking about.
Gower's Drugs. Miss Blaine?
In this case, the ringing phone and dialogue are part of our mid signal. Our music and ambience are filling up the mid and the side parts of the mix. Let's say we decide our music is making the center elements hard to hear. We could just turn down the music, but instead, let's use mid-side processing to just turn down the mid signal and make more room in the center of the mix without affecting the overall volume of the music as much.
Gower's Drugs. Miss Blaine?
We can get even more precise if we want to. I'm going to send the music to two aux tracks that split the music into the mid and side signals. Then I'm going to put an equalizer on the mid signal. Since our ringing telephone is mostly in the high end above 400 Hz, I'm going to take out the high end in the music to make more room for the telephone without affecting the low end or the side elements of the music. If we compare that to filtering the entire musical signal, you can see how transparent mid-side processing is.
Gower's Drugs. Miss Blaine? Gower's Drugs.
There's so much potential with mid-side processing. You can use any plugin or effect on only the middle or the side elements of a track or mix. That opens up a ton of potential for very transparent and subtle processing that can go a long way to making your track sound professional and polished. Anyway, that's it for this video. If you liked this video, if you found it useful and interesting, hit that like button. Feel free to hit the dislike button. If you have any more questions or comments, feel free to leave those down in the comment section down below. And if you want to see more videos like this, including more videos where we go even more in depth on techniques like mid-side, definitely hit that subscribe button.